रामाय राम भद्राय रामचंद्राय वेदसे रघुनाथाय नाथाय सीताय पति ए नमः। सुंदरकांड चैप्टर नंबर 10, द कंटिन्यूएशन ऑफ रावणस हैरम। द रेसिटेशन बिगिंस नाउ। Maruti came upon a couch of crystals inlaid with gems, even like the bed of the Lord of the Celestials. All around it were arranged many seats and lounges wrought of emeralds and sapphires, chased with gold and ivory, and covered with priceless carpets and rugs. On one side of it, there stood a huge umbrella of spotless white, like the moon in her full, decorated with garlands of pearls and ropes of gems. That bed of Ravana, fashioned of pure molten gold of 1,008 carats, lighted the place even like the noonday sun. It was hung with festoons of Ashoka and other flowers, flower-soft skins of rare animals, priceless shawls, rugs and coverlets, feather beds were to be found on it. It hid under the clouds of flowers of various hue. It was redolent with saffron, musk, aloes, sandal, and other rare perfumes. Countless maidens with chowries in their hands stood along its edges, wrought of gold and gem, and curiously fashioned as to waft the soft breeze at all times. And upon it, the dread Lord of Lanka lay asleep, dark of hue, even like the surcharged rain clouds of winter. His arms were strong, stout, and round like the graceful tusks of elephants. His eyes were red like blazing flames. His face was adorned with earrings blazing like the sun. The priceless garment of gold that he wore shone like flash of lightning playing against dark cloud banks. The crimson sandal paste of rare make that adorned his huge chest and arms blowed like a red cloud at sunset with chained lightning playing through it. He could take any form at will, and he lay there as beautiful and fascinating as the god of love to steal the hearts of his wives. He was lost in deep sleep, the result of long and varied dalliance and drink. Maruti beheld Ravana in his repose, the beloved lord of the Rakshasa ladies and the dispenser of everything great and good and glorious to his countless subjects, and was betrayed into an exclamation. It is verily the lordly mountain Mandara in deep sleep with its trees, bushes and woods and rivers. But unspeakable grief almost brought tears to his eyes at the sight of Ravana, who reclined there breathing regularly and heavily like a huge serpent hissing forth in ungovernable wrath. Alas, what heinous sin have I been guilty of in that my eyes rested upon the foul abductor of Lady Janaki, even before I could bless my eyes with the sight of her whom I have sought far and wide. He drew back a pace as if he was unable to face a dreadful elemental or some fierce beast of prey, for, said he to himself, it ill becomes me to stay near this vile sinner. Then he got up a platform near it and gazed again steadily at Ravana. The huge bed looked like a mountain torrent in the rains, hid beneath the herds of dun elephants in rut, as Ravana lay there in the arms of sleep with his mighty shoulders like the trunks of elephants and gracefully adorned with sandal paste of rare perfume. For his graceful arms were very long and reached his knees like the banners of Indra raised in honor of the Lord of Heaven. Like the pillars of smothered iron or steel, beaten into graceful shape, they were inconceivably hard and gradually tapered like the trunks of elephants. They were perfectly similar, most mighty, with well-knit joints and graced with perfectly formed fingers, toes, and nails. His hands lay by his side like two huge five-headed serpents in repose, its fingers adorned with costly rings. His shoulders, covered with gold armlets, were covered with the scars when they challenged the Indra's elephant and broke off its tusks. It bore the marks of the mighty battle with Vishnu himself when his dread chakra inflicted but deep wounds thereon. Verily, they shone like countless full moons on a black sky. They were adorned with curious designs worked in sandal paste, sweet, cool, fragrant, and red like the blood of the hare. In fact, they were saturated with rare perfumes. Noble ladies vied with one another in massaging them. They were the holy terror of the Yakshas, the Gandharvas, Devas, the Asuras, and other denizens of the high world. Maruti beheld those powerful arms flung in deep sleep. They reminded him of the vast pythons in the midst of the mountain Mandara, hissing in wrath and lying torpid after the heavy meal of beasts and birds. In fact, the huge mountainous bulk of Ravana was fitly adorned with those arms of perfect form and shape, even like two lofty peaks. The breath that issued from him filled that vast sleeping salon with the fragrance of the essences of fruits and flowers, the variety of food and drinks, rare and costly. His crown of gold slipped a little one side, heavy with priceless gems and pearls. The sheen of his earrings brightened up his face all over. His vast, broad and mighty chest was adorned with curious design in sandal paste. Garlands and ropes of pearls and gems lay upon it. His upper garments of silk and gold were slightly disordered. The cloth of gold that he wore on his loins blinded the eyes with its luster. With flaming eyes and huge stalk like a hill of black pearls, he lay asleep there, hissing like a huge snake or like a mighty elephant in deep sleep on the rolling waters of the Ganges. The vast hall was filled with noonday radiance from the bright lights of the countless lamps of precious stones on the tops of golden columns. And it was thus that Maruti beheld Ravana and his favorite ladies that lay at his feet all around in deep sleep. His body resembled a cloud through which flashed lightnings, casting a blinding radiance all around. Those favorites of his shone in the splendor of their countenance that put to shame the moon in its full. They wore earrings of rare designs and garlands that never faded. Some of them charmed away the heart of Ravana by their skill in song and dance and were richly rewarded by him with priceless ornaments. And there they lay upon his arms and breast and lap, overcome with resistless sleep in the midst of their dalliance. Some rested their fair heads upon their shapely arms adorned with ornaments and gems. And so it was that the sheen of the armlets ran into that of the earrings and blazed fiercely. Verily, that hall resembled the blue vaults of heaven with its lovely faces like the moon and the earrings that resembled like star clusters. In the pride of their youth and vigor, they indulged themselves long with Ravana and fell asleep as they were. One of them, a vision of loveliness, was an expert in the art of dance and gesticulation. She won the heart of her lord with her graceful movements and a skillful exposition of the emotions, and fell asleep, her arms crystallized in the perfect poise of movements. Another of them, a paragon of beauty, compelled the admiration of Ravana by her peerless proficiency on the veena and fell asleep, clasping it in her arms. She looked like a graceful lotus stalk in its beauty of leaf and flower, borne on the bosom of a torrent and twined round a canoe that came upon accidentally in its course. Another fell asleep, her arms clasped fondly round a maduka, resembling a mother with her darling babe on her hip. Another lay with her arms thrown around the pataha, as if she were a wife who was united to the lord of her heart after a long separation. Another lay with a flute clasped firmly between her breasts, as if she sought long and ardently for a chance to embrace her beloved, and came upon him all unaware in a sweet privacy. Yet another slept with her arms fondly cast around a vipanchi, as if she was in her own rooms in absolute privacy. She was an expert dancer, and her voice was soft and low. Another clasped to her breast a mridanga, and sleep overcame her. Her eyes were dim with intoxication and moved ever so lightly. Her limbs were well shaped and soft and smooth, like a creeper made of gold. One of her friends, thin of waist, fell under the influence of wine and lay asleep with a panava tightly clasped between her flanks and arms. There was a lovely maiden who fell asleep with one arm around a dindima and firmly clasped to her breast its fellow in the crook of her other arm, even like a wife who embraced fondly her husband and babe at the same time. One of her mates fell asleep with an adambara between her breasts. Yonder reclined another vision of loveliness with a gemmed jug upturned for a pillow. The remains of sandal paste mixed with saffron trickled from it rightly over her limbs and reminded Maruti of a garland sprinkled with water against the summer heat. Yet another graceful lady fought long and vainly against a fit of drowsiness, and yet she had the instinct of a maiden modesty to hide from view with her flower-soft hands the golden globes of her breasts. It was a curious sight to see another of the wives of Ravana who clasped to her breast one of her friends under the impression that she was her Lord Ravana himself, for the treacherous wine cup was too much for her, and so those noble dames lay asleep all around, their arms thrown fondly over the musical instruments, even as they would embrace their beloved. And as Anjaneya passed them, he came upon a bed most magnificently furnished and standing all apart, and upon it lay in deep sleep a lady who was, as it were, the perfect womanhood came down to the mortal world. Ornaments of gold, gems and pearls graced her limbs. The splendor of her body irradiated the space around in its hue of molten gold, 1,008 carats in quality. She was a fitting ornament to that Pushpaka Vimana, like a full moon in the blue sky in all her radiance and glory. She was none other than Mandodari, the queen of Ravana, whose fame extended to the corners of the world. She was dearer to him than his very life. She was supreme over all his wives and women. Anjaneya noticed her wonderful youth, beauty, grace, and loveliness. He almost convinced himself that he had, after all, come upon the object of his quest, the wonderful lady Sita. He was overcome with joy, and most naturally, he slapped his mighty shoulders, he kissed his tail, he took short flying leaps and madly gambolled about. He sang to himself, he danced a measure or two, he paced the hall as if treading upon air, he jumped upon the tall columns there and lightly leaped to the ground. And he could not keep himself from being betrayed into all the pranks most natural to his class. Mangalam Kushlendraya Mahaniya Gunapte Chakravarti Dhanurjaya Sarva Bhomaya Mangalam.